So like I said, Lower Puna Rising, we walked through these steps of visioning, and that's what we're going to do together, is the first two steps. So the first one is sort of just to get into character, to create a statement of intention. So what we're going to do that is we're going to sort of call on three aspects of ourselves, sort of a higher, sort of a heart-centered, and sort of a root-centered, right? Like, and the root is going to be like what your needs are, your immediate needs. Your heart is going to be kind of like what you would like or what you would love to see. And your higher is like what's important to me. And so we're going to, from these adjectives that we're going to write down, we'll create a statement of intention. And that is going to be sort of a clear identifier of what is important, what matters, and what we love in this community. And as we go along, we'll go back to this statement of intention. And like, what we're going to do is we're going to start with sort of our higher self, right? We're going to start with, like, what's important to you, right? So this is like, you know, you're up on a soapbox, and it's like this aspect of yourself that, like, it really has these strong values, right? What are your values? So it's really helpful to just say that. It's important to me that it's this. It's important to me that it's that. And pick up a marker and just start writing. Please write legibly and write say it out loud. So then what you say may trigger someone else. And that's how we kind of get the collective group mind going, right?
What's important to me that it's beautiful.
Right, that it's beautiful.
This thing we're going to create.
That we're going to create, right. It's important to you that it's what? Right. Community is involved, just like now. Nice. Thank you for that. Maybe it's important that it's easeful. That it's inclusive and fun. Let me hear you say it out loud. It's important to me that
it's healthy.
That it's peaceful. That it's healthy and
respectful.
Right. It's important too that we have these workshops together.
Yeah, it's cultural.
Me too. It's important to you that's what? Human treatment? Humane treatment. Sweet. What's important to you? What else? Let me hear you say it. It's important to me that it's... If you say it, you may trigger it in someone else too. Right. Right. Nice one, Uncle. Appreciate that.
Equitable,
beautiful adjective.
Yes. That's what I was thinking now too.
How do you spell it?
I don't know.
You didn't get that far?
Don't ask me. I went to art school.
What was the word?
Accessible.
It is
accessible.
So this is our higher selves. This is like our true values, our aspirations. This is what we hold dear. This is things that we can't waver on. These are things that are non-negotiable. These are things that are important to us. Right. Well, what is the crucible of that? In the middle still. So these are our higher ideals. These are things that are unwaverable. These are things that we hold to be true. It's important to us. Nice. Good job, everyone.
Here in Puna, should be thinking about composting or manure because you guys don't have proper drainage for your sewer system. Do it. It's not very hard. I have some composting toilets on my farm corner, and I have a toilet in my house. I don't have a system.
Right. Okay, so we're going to transition to the next part. It's a similar exercise, but we're just going to add to our current web of. Nice job, everyone. It's really colorful and. And looks, I like that joyous is big over there, that's nice. So we're going to transition to the next part, and we're going to move that energy down to our heart. And these are things that we'd like to see, or that we would love, that sort of matter to us. These are sort of, I would like this, or I would like that, you know, it would feel good to me to see that kind of stuff. Maybe these are things that we can waver on, but they're still have meaning to us. So one of the ways that you can get into that character, into that heart character is just, you know, saying, I would like it to be. I would like it to be this. I would like it to be that. And so let's do just a few minutes around of that, saying that out loud. I would like this, or I like that, or I love this, or whatever. And sort of, now's the time to dream. There's no wrong answers. And play with that a little bit.
On the same paper?
On the same paper.
I would like it to be easy.
Right. Easy.
I would like it to be one movement.
Right. Unified. Nice. I would like that too. I would like it to be.
You would like it to be an example.
Well, just so it's open to.
We want fuel.
It's an example. Nice. Paraphrase that. Write it down. Share that. That's an important thing for you. So it's nice to put it down now. How are we doing over here? I would like it to be. Anybody got one last round? Anything? Looking good.
Did anybody write inclusive yet? Inclusive of being a yet.
This is your needs. This is your childish self, right? Like, you're not thinking of your higher self or your heart. You're just like, I want this and I want that. Get it out. You can even throw a little tantrum. Say your name. Get it. What? Say it out loud. I want this. I want that.
I want chocolate.
Right. She wants chocolate. That's a real need. Write that down. And it's a need that we can fulfill. Come on. I know there's a lot more inner characters, inner children over here than are being expressed. Say it out loud. I want this. I want it to be magic. I want it to be awesome. I want it.
Got creative. Okay.
These are so beautiful, everyone. Nice job. Okay, good job. So everybody kind of understands what's important to us, what we like, what we need, and we're create a statement of intention with that, right? So we'll build a little paragraph that says, for this community, it's important to them that they have this, that they want that, that they would like to see this. Says that was statement of intention. That was the initial parts of it. It's not done, of course. That's just to get sort of the ball rolling. And clear intention is how we... Plus direct action is how we make magic happen, right? So people say manifest this, do that, but you can't do any of that unless you have a clear intention. So creating a statement of intention for any project that you have going, taking the time to do a process like this is really helpful, right? Rather than just, you know, I'm going to make this or I'm going to do this or whatever before you build anything or craft anything, sit down and sort of spend some time with a statement of intention and see what it is exactly, what's important to you, what you're needing, and what you'd like to see. And some people know brainstorming, right? You just list things, or free writing, or mind mapping. And mind mapping is a tool that's been used for thousands of years, and it helps us navigate the interiors of our mind through pathways and synapses and nodes. And it sort of like takes that complicated structure and lays it out into a visual form. And from that, we're going to branch out with arms or tentacles or things like that. It's sort of a fractal pattern, right? Let me give you an example. So if you're designing a garden, you may have garden in the middle, and then you may have paths and beds and walls and plants. And under plants, you may have annuals and perennials. And under perennials, you may have a whole bunch of things, right? And so you might not get to that tip of that fractal pattern, that tip of that branch, if you hadn't gone through all of it. So individually, it's a beautiful tool. But collectively, it's super powerful, because now it's sort of like this noosphere, you know, collective brain energy, where one person says one thing, and that links another person to another thing, and then we're bouncing off of each other. Say it out loud so other people can hear. Use like your like inner like playful self, your inner stoner self, your inner like, you know, kid self, right? Like, it's like, dude, what about this and what about that? There's no editing, right? Like, just playful, get it out, whatever, you know. Let's do a few more minutes of this and really flesh out what are the parts of that. Think about yourself as one of your kids or part of that system, and if they were here and if they could speak, what would they say? What's important to them?
Yeah. You got microorganisms on
there? Right. Speak. I am the Lorax. I speak for the microorganisms. And they need what? So what do we got going on over there? All the... It's okay. Say it out loud, though. So you might want to... You might envision something for something else. What do you got? Okay, nice.
All this stuff is like...
But each one has a subcategory, is what you're
suggesting.
Except
maybe animal food, I don't know, is that soil?
That's perennials. You know what, it's just energy.
What do you write down there?
It's
like have you gone to
any... Why is our energy? Why
have you,
is energy?
Have you gone to any of the Puna currency meetings yet?
No.
Look it up.
Okay,
Puna
one final
currency.
Round here. If you've got anything left in you,
having our,
from your chicken perspective, your children's perspective, you or your partner's perspective,
and, sometimes
the microorganism.
Air creep down.
Social things like dance, music, massage.
Social gatherings.
Yeah.
Community gatherings.
Yeah.
Thanks, Tom, for bringing that up. We could have built a whole system that didn't consider people's needs in that way.
Yeah.
Without, that's how important these mind maps are. We're going to expand our center of awareness from ourselves and our family into like what I would call our neighborhood, right? So if you live in OPCAL, maybe it's, you know, the people, you know, 5 houses down this way and 10 houses down that way, or it's all the people in Kapoho or Nanavali or whatever. So you're going to sort of expand it into your neighborhood or your development or whatever. So if we were now to take self-reliance, community resiliency, food security, and expand it, what new aspects enter into our mind maps? What are some new possibilities? As we look at some of the things we talked about earlier with like tool shares and labor pools and co-ops, what things would we add to that map now that it's not just us, but it's how we interact as a neighborhood? What's that, Uncle?
Share knowledge.
Share knowledge. And how would we do that? Would it be education, library?
Those that don't know, make it known.
Right. And write down how to do that, like a library, posting boards, internet.
Network of trade and barter.
Community library.
So as we think of our neighborhood, what aspects?
How about governmental?
Respect our neighbor.
Government is important for our
IQ. Right. The Konohiki. Right. Right, on the ahupua'a. I just think of like the Konohiki.
Yeah, that's the kind of government.
Right, right. Grassroots. Right.
There's no grocery store.
But because we didn't think about grocery store because we were just talking about ourselves. But now grocery store comes into it. Or market. Or there you go. There you go. Food access. Food access could be the branch and then there could be lots of, right? So go with that. Someone go with that. Say it out loud. Add to it. So this is food security, self-reliance strategies. We know what best practices look like. We're visioning the future, so that might answer your question. How are we looking over here? So we're expanding that system, not just us anymore. It's now our neighborhood.
I know we talk about like
so. There's distribution. There's processing.
And like my experience here over only 2 years has been there's so many people into that, but it's difficult with like also the way the government operates. It's like it's almost like
so let's bring it back in here together and try to keep this vision going a little bit further. So now it's a neighborhood system, right? So there's more complications than just our personal system, but there's also maybe more benefits, right? So what else can we think about as far as like interacting with other people? Alternative currency, is that on there?
The hardest thing for me is being new to this community.
Distribution, storage, processing.
I think that would come off of culture.
Yeah, we've got that.
More people chosen
that incorporated town.
But we also have an opportunity to change the political system now. That's part of this too. So as we move from individual and family into the community, like what are some of the flows of energy that happen as far as like alternative currency, distribution, storage, processing? Like now we're interacting with more and more people that are outside of our family. What needs to happen? Maybe conscious communication classes, education system be put on right away. What's that? Starting with kids. So make sure that makes it on the map.
We're about to be a little bit
expensive. It shouldn't have to be more than that. Right.
It
can't read upside down by the belly, you don't walk around.
Right. Most tropical places I live, that's kind of the strategy.
Drumming, let's highlight that one.
Because you got to go all year, right? So
yeah,
I'm back in Nebraska, okay, where I'm from the farm, which I work in spring and fall quite a bit. And then winter, you're down. But here, all year, so you got to take it easy. You got to take that all day pace, all year pace, right?
There's someone from Puna who has an airfree house in Thailand.
Okay.
Steve is his name. That's all I know about that.
Because there were those guys that did that workshop here. You guys remember that?
Yeah,
yeah, I think we had him for a couple of years.
Right. You get some of your individual needs met.
Or if everyone is working on all of these little things, it would all work. We need, like, manager for, like, everything.
Right.
And I
you definitely could do this by yourself.
Right. We need a team. We're going to, again, we're going to take our sphere and we're going to expand it, right? We're going to expand it to our larger community or our region, right? So it could be Puna or Lower Puna. It's larger now. If we expand that now, not just our neighborhood, and some of there might be some crossover, but if now if we expand that to a larger system, then we can see that now we're operating on a much bigger scale. There may be tool shares that have backhoes, and there may be feed stores, there may be, you know, these larger kind of things. So with the whatever remaining room you have on your paper, sort of expand that concept one bit further. Now you're thinking, so Puna's 50,000 people, right? Now you're thinking on a larger scale. You're thinking Puna-wide. If you were to expand self-reliance, food security, community resiliency to 50,000 people, what aspects of what you already have exist and what aspects need to be created? The government might be part of this a little bit now for the first time.
I didn't write that. We have drumming here and it's over there.
Right. Nice. Get it, girl. Right. Well, yeah, it's still happening how this is happening. And my job is to help vision it, right? And so once the vision gets there and people show up, then we look for funding. And but no sense taking it to a funding level if there's not people willing to run it. So. Nice. So let's take a few minutes to flesh out some of the details. So look at sort of the ends of these things and see if there can be a few more branches, right? So is there a few more like details that we can add? Because if we don't capture it now, we might not have it later. Right. Right, so you need actually things benefit when there's more people using it. Okay, cuz. That's so sweet. So sweet. Spokesperson for this group, someone that would like to communicate to this group what they learned or what they discovered. Is there anyone, one or two people that are wanting to do that? And over here as well, is there a spokesperson for this group that would like to communicate to this group?
Well, that community is really diverse. There's a lot of different things that make us humans. We kind of depend on energy, communication, we need shelter, we need medicine, we need land, most of all. And our own currency to allow us to live on this land until we figure out the way of having our land tax free. And we need community space and a lot of different things.
Right. Wade?
Yeah, and we need soil and food and all kinds of different crops. Education, access to food, building material, shelter, eco-friendly building practices.
Is there anything that you discovered as a group? Anyone in the group can speak to that you discovered that you didn't really recognize as part of the food security or self-reliance or community resiliency that was sort of a surprise to you that might not be considered generally?
For me, the idea that it was a community effort, because you know, all the movies I've watched and most of the things I've thought about was about me and
right.
my immediate flock, if you will. Not right. the community at large, but my compound, my
right.
I don't know, what have you, and sustaining it and making it operate from relying on anything other than us.
Right.
And now incorporating that in a community, 50,000 people.
Right.
Makes better sense. It makes me safer
right.
as an individual, knowing that everybody's in compliance with this idea, this right. mindset that I hope is, you know, offers peace.
Right. A good
peace of mind.
A good system in permaculture has redundancy, right? So if one part is to fail, the other part would pick up. So. And we have redundancy when we have the resiliency of the community. So thanks for that. That's for sure. Okay, awesome. Nice.
We have a lot of what the first team had. And so what we wanted to focus on is, of course, the hands, because it takes a lot of hands to get a lot of this stuff moving and shaking.
Nice.
And so forth. I think one of the things that we have, and you probably have the same thing, is we have to look at our barriers. You know, we have to look at that, and then from there, start deciding what can we do as a group and as a team to start doing a lot of this stuff, not only in our own backyard, but into the next backyard, and then eventually into our community. And so we have a lot of culturally based stuff, and I think that's always important for all of us, even if you're just visiting or you wasn't born here on the island. Because we all come from backgrounds, and so we all can learn from each other's value systems that might have came right out of our own homes. And so if we can, there's things on here that took us to legislature and changing laws and all of that, but we know that we're the movers and the shakers, and we want things done now. So what do we have control of that we can make the changes now and eventually build on our numbers and our assets, and then take it to legislature and all of that? Because if we can show them that we have the meat to some of the stuff that we've already started, then most times they'll listen to us, and then they'll start to work with us. So for me, one of my biggest things is starting barter and trade networking clubs, because we have a lot of people out here that have products and services. And if we can start just from one village at a time and build on our directory, then it'll start to evolve. And that's just one of my suggestions. But I notice everybody else got a lot of good stuff on here, from our health-related stuff. We lack resources out here. And if we can be the ones to bring those resources right here into our communities and into our neighborhoods, through a networking and barter club or a networking and barter directory, I think it'll be beneficial to a lot of us. Not only us, but the next generation. And if we can start teaching our children how to utilize money in a different form of currency, which is through barter and networking, then that's what we need to do now.
Awesome. Thank you so much.
Because the issues are here, and it's going to continue staying here if we're not going to continue to come together like this in different walks of life and make the necessary changes.
Perfect. So beautiful.
That's our skill.
Beautiful. Is there anything that anyone in this group would suggest they were surprised that came up around self-reliance or community resiliency?
Clothing. One that I've never thought of, and I've never heard anybody talk about. It like popped up, but I've never heard that before.
Right.
It shows how. We can go back to what our ancestors did. They just wore a piece of cloth.
Uh-huh. That's our official proposal. No.
Right.
One of the themes I saw was reoccurring when we were thinking smaller was a lot of sharing, like sharing in abundance, sharing with neighbors. And it was interesting to me that as we started thinking larger picture, I didn't see that reoccurring anymore.
Right.
Like the abundance of those systems sharing back.
Why do you think that is? It just gets more complicated, or?
Yeah, I think it's. it seems like it's a value everybody holds, because everybody, when we're thinking of our local homes and our neighbors, we were thinking like, oh, sharing what we have and trading and doing all those things. And as it got bigger, it seemed to like to stay away from that.
Is there any, Tom?
I just wanted to point out one thing they had on theirs. I don't think we had. I see Ho'oponopono.
Oh, yeah.
And I think that's really good, some kind of conflict resolution system so that
accountability.
We had nonviolent communication, and I think it should be compulsory for everybody.
I really think, like, when I think about the global world perspective, I mean,
at least the
and from a community perspective, like, when you're living with people, conflict resolution becomes really important,
right?
How to get along with each other, and when something doesn't go right and there's conflict, how to resolve that.
Right.
And when you look at that from a global place, like, that's still where our biggest problems are.
Right.
And, like, figuring out how to do that on all levels is so important.
More of a discussion about where we are right now around getting these this done, and where we need to put some of our energy for where we want to be. So we're going to talk about systems that are in place right now that are already working. So that's going to be really informative for people, I think, the systems that are already working that you can participate in. And then where are our gaps or opportunities for growth? And that's going to be the nature of the last part of the discussion. So let's take 10, 15 minutes and chat it up. You know, I have a story that when people move here and they get buried in self-reliant strategies and building their house and making their farm that, you know, maybe their head's down for a while they're working the soil, and they forget to look up and they forget to talk to so many other people that are doing the exact same thing, and that we can learn from each other. So that's the nature of these meetings, and that's why I want to celebrate all of you for coming. Because the more that we do this, the more that we learn from each other, the stronger we become. And these self-reliant systems then take on a redundancy. And there's some safety in that, right? There's safety in interdependent living, right? And that's, if nothing else, I want to encourage that as a strategy for self-reliance, to move from independence to interdependence, to imagine yourself as part of a system, an indispensable part of system, giving your unique offering to the system, right? What is that you feel excited about? What are you passionate about? What are you good at? What does the community need? Let all these considerations come into place, and in the middle will be some special little magic bit that is unique to you that you can offer to the community and get your needs met as far as abundance and financial needs, and that you can make yourself an indispensable aspect of the larger system in interdependence, right? So this is how it used to be. My hope is that as I told the story of long time ago here in this place, that you feel connected to that story, that this is the story of humanity, that this is our story as people living here on this land. We do have cars and petrol and internet, and sometimes these things are helpful, and sometimes they hold us back as they foster complacency and individualism and entitlement. We might not show up every day with the same vigor that our ancestors did. But thinking about it as a group, thinking about it as a we rather than a me, is the transition that I want to encourage. Okay? So what we're going to do is talk about the mind map that we just did and the vision of sustainability. Now, I want to be clear that I'm not trying to be dogmatic around the Konohiki concept. That's for people that are ready. It can be just self-reliance on a personal level, right? And that is beautiful and that is perfect. And there's no hierarchy or way that's right. If the backyard revolution, you're showing up in your own garden and you're reducing your carbon footprint and you're buying things locally, that's beautiful and that's perfect, and keep doing that. If you're ready then to engage in a larger system by making a product and trading or by any number of things, then please feel free to expand your circle and do that. And on that note, I do come across people who feel disenfranchised by the sustainability community, self-reliant movement, because they're not a farmer, right? And I want to dispel any notion that that is everything that you need to be. the new paradigm world or the shift or this self-reliant world has clothes makers, and it has massage therapists, and it has graphic designers, and it has accountants, and it has people that that make shoes and weave hair and dance and teach, and like all of that stuff is part of it. So if you're really tapping into your unique offering and what the community needs, and it's coming from your heart rather than a place of greed or separation, and it's coming as an offering, chances are you're in alignment, right? You don't have to be a farmer, you know. Farmers need help with other things. And the system, as we know it, is quite large. So before we talk about what is working and what needs to be done, go to the back of this handout. And, you know, on these handouts is my website, www.rising.earth. You can go to that, and there's a projects tab, and there's a our Konohiki tab. And you can find PDFs to, like, Puna development and ahupua'a. And so, it's a tough word. Thanks for that. And so you can go to the website, to our Konohiki, and you can look up a lot of these things, some of these printouts, and so all the work that I've done around that. And take a card, and you can email me or whatever. You know, we're not, this is not a business I'm not selling. This is a concept that we're trying to get out. It's very different than an entrepreneur who would make a business plan and hide it from everybody so they can get rich. As a social innovator is what I define my, apparently that's what I am. It sounds a little bit funny. A community organizer, not as much, but social programs and add innovation and spread them. It's very different than an entrepreneur where you guard your wisdom. This is like you try to give it away and you try to get people to participate, right? So it's a different energy. So go to my website, please, and look on there and read some of this information and email me if you're interested in discussing this further. Also, a small plug for Lower Puna Rising. If you have a project, like your church group or your community or your family or anything, if you have a project that you're looking to sort of bring to fruition or make some movement on, contact me. I'd be happy to share my process with you. I'd be happy to come host some workshops with your group. It's just sometimes nice if you're stuck or stagnant to have a third party come in and help grease the wheels and get things done, right? So this process. Well, I guess like in a more proactive way, like we focus on the solutions, but I'm not a therapist or anything like that. So, but I know some people that would be good for that. So anyway, like I was saying, sorry I got distracted. On the back of this page is just a graphic I found online called The Food System. And it talks about different parts of the food system, pre-production, farming, the direct marketing chain, processing, storage, distribution, consumption, waste management. The idea here is just to think, you know, we're talking about food security, we're not necessarily talking about just putting plants in the ground, putting them in our mouth, right? It's a big system. As soon as you think about your family and you extend that further, it becomes a bigger and bigger system. So there are people, there are organizations, some people have come up to me during this workshop and told me about them, and I would love to hear from you now. This is a great opportunity. There are some organizations that are already working on some of these things, working on aspects of these things, like say the food basket is one I know. They collect food and they make sure people get food. This is part of the food production system. Is there anyone that would like to share systems that they know that are in place that are part of this system that we can maybe support energetically, that we can put our thoughts and prayers towards, that we can volunteer with, that we can help raise money? Go for it.
I'm primarily a livestock person, but we have resources available through OH and the Extension Service, and there's a lot of things in process right now. There's a pig producers co-op that's just been started. Next week up the mountain, they're doing a workshop. Someone's building a piggery, and they're teaching people by doing how bedding system for these farmers that are just getting started. So everybody's going to show up if you've never seen it done or don't know how to do it or want to learn how to do it. The Pig Producers Co-op, there are all kinds of associations and groups. There's the East Hawaii Cacao Growers. There's the Tropical Food Producers. There's just all kinds of people. And, you know, most of these are business people, and they're interested in, you know, the bigger picture, not just necessarily the marketing and profit, but, you know, how can we co-op with equipment and labor and resources? So there's a lot of this stuff going on in official or unofficial ways. Mm. And I think that the networking piece of it is really important. So, you know, I'm not making a plug here, but Google is an outstanding resource. Mm-hmm. You know, the Korean Natural Farming, which is now called Cho Global Natural Farming, heavily involved in saving ohia and food sustainability and co-oping labor and resources and information and the certifications that, you know, I heard you speak to today. Now there's a system that's working on getting in place for certifying people at different steps of the way. Right. For that natural farming system. It's really exciting and, to me, horribly overwhelming.
Right.
Because I'm at the place where, you know, the D9 just left. Right. And I got rabbits. And I got a protein source going in. You know, I'm making beds and building things and planting bananas. And it's just me.
Right.
So I want to be involved in this kind of thing, but it's like, I gotta go home and plant some more papaya.
Right. Your struggle is real, sister.
Yes,
for
indeed.
Sure.
And I'm self-reliant, and I've never had anybody to rely on, so it's really difficult for me to get to a different place. And I'm an entrepreneur. I've been self-employed my whole life. And so I need to learn about how to work toward that interdependence place.
Right. And what is your name?
My name's Candy Holovio.
Okay, welcome. Awesome.
So anyway, SPACE, I think, is working well. They have a school. They have an after-school circus program. I'm the president of the board there, so I'm encouraging you to support SPACE. And if you know people with kids that, you know, want to learn some good skills and be part of the community, have them join in there. And yeah, here with yoga classes and dance classes, like there is a lot going on. So I kind of think that's like the low hanging fruit. It's like just kind of keep supporting here and have that grow and add to it whatever you're bringing to what's already going on. And so just keep like, you know, tell them like keep supporting one sanctuary, SPACE, and Kalani and their community program, especially when they're free for the public.
Absolutely. Thanks.
So things that are in place and the system is working, and I wanna echo what Michelle just said too about, you know, about the classes that I'm teaching, free educational events that give people the tools and then they need for all these things. So things in the food system that are working, I see the farmers markets working really well. I see locavore is an excellent example.
Amen.
Right? Amen. Locavore store. It's a store in Hilo where it's all local stuff. They've got local meat, they've got local produce, they've got local flowers, they've got local value-added products. All locally sourced. It's Bayfront Hilo, right? At the far end of Bayfront Hilo, right before you go over the bridge. It's right in that strip there. It's a store. And it's an excellent example. They used to have a store in Pahoa. I'd like to see. And at SPACE, yeah, they started out as in a farmer's market in SPACE, and then they got a store in Pahoa, and then they got a store in Hilo. So I'd love to see like that come back to Pahoa. But still in Pahoa, we have Island Naturals, and in Island Naturals shelves, their produce, it's, you know, there's stuff that's labeled locally.
Right.
You just gotta be, okay, this is what I'm getting. I'm eating locally, so there's local broccoli, there's local tomatoes, there's local cucumbers, there's local sprouts, lettuce, you know, so pretty much I feel like if I'm not growing it, then I can buy it locally.
Right. Sweet.
I'm Ryan Gonzalez,
and we're part of the group known as the Bodacious Women of Hawaii. And so we've been operating before Hurricane Isao and have been operating till now. And so what we do is we're a nonprofit, and we purchase our food from the food basket warehouse at a low cost. We service from Upper Puna down to all Lower Puna. So we have 14 subdivisions as our branches, which we have two gatekeepers per subdivision that'll come up and pick up the food. And of course, the food is non-perishable food item. At times, we'll get fruits and vegetables, but it's such a very limited supply. So we make our kupunas our top priority whenever any fruit, anything fresh come in and we can't give out to everybody, our kupunas become our priority. During the summer months is when our numbers go up really high, and we have serviced 800 families just in the Puna area. Our numbers is, after summer months, it'll fluctuate between 550 to 600. And that's one person coming through the line to pick up food for their family to take back into their subdivision. So the food pantries are working. This year, one of our biggest goals is to collaborate with farmers, whether you're a small farmer, large farmer, backyard farmer. We'd like to try and collaborate and get donations of these fruits coming in. We see a lot of fruit trees many times that they ain't even picking the fruit. So I'll go and knock on their door and say, can we pick a bucket or two of fruit? You know, so so the food pantries work. We are gonna start expanding out to Pahala in May. And just from the emergency food drop that happened this month, was it this month? Yeah, on the 18th. 144 families came out, and majority of them was kupuna. So like you shared earlier, Nico, is as we focus on puna, is it gonna just be one-sided puna or but it took us 3 years to get enough funding to now spread out that far and start going up the mountain. So starting next month, we'll have Pahala coming down, Eden Rock, Hawaiian Acres, and then every subdivision all on this side.
Awesome.
And then one more thing I forgot. Since Hurricane Isao, we started natural disaster preparedness meetings. That is held every second Wednesday of the month at 10 o'clock. And we do have now civil defense and county, and all of these people will come out to this meeting to be a whole part of what we need to do here in Puna.
I've been going to the Korean natural farming meetings. I was here last year doing healing, I went all last winter, and I think that's a very good group. I think it's the second or third Tuesday potluck at 6 o'clock. You can look it up. I'm very much interested in that.
Where's
it
at?
It's at the Sweet King Cafe now.
I'm James Weatherford. I'll use the understood this is about what's working. Well, I could say Elizabeth and I are working very hard. And the farm's working pretty well. And if you're not afraid of the word work, as it just so happens, or more than the word work, we have a cabin and we need someone there to help us. So there's someone here if you want to pass the word. We've got quite a lot to do. Glad to be here and very appreciative of Hawaiian Sanctuary being here. And
is working well. Something else is working well is greens that we got here at a workshop years ago. Thanks to Wade.
Perennial greens.
Perennial greens. They are well established in two locations, and probably from what we shared with other people in others as well. And I highly recommend perennial greens. You put them in the ground, you take care of them, and you keep eating on them forever and ever, and they shake the ground.
I live in a farm community in Kapoho. We got 15 acres going right up to Boom Lake Mountain. It's called Pi'ilani Farms. And we're a group of young folks just here to love the land and learn how to be sustainable. And we've got about 15 people living there now. And our focus is, like I said, food and sustainability. What's working for us is the social aspect of our community, just figuring out how to live together with other people. And I think a big part of that is being clear with our intentions of what we're doing and why we're doing it, and creating the space for communication, having a weekly meeting every Monday morning for us to sit like we're doing right now and look each other in the face and talk about all the things we need to talk about. So anything from working on the land to personal dynamics that need to be discussed. And also we've done a lot of projects with the community. We've done, if you guys have heard of Go Kuleana, we've done kids programs there, bringing kids onto the farm, getting them, teaching them the aspects of natural building, and acro yoga, drumming, and gardening, all that kind of stuff.
I'm Justin, and we've been on the island not that long, under 2 years. And we live right down, just down the road here on the border of Kapoho. We've lived on our land since October, and we're just building our existence, trying not to get too heads down and tunnel vision, and we're trying to engage and come to groups like this and come to different meetups. And it's hard to do sometimes because you get so, there's so much to do. To forget there's things going on around you. From the time we've been here, the one thing I've seen that I think works well is the community, definitely like as a whole, like Puna or like Lower Puna, it seems like we've had no problems, if you're not afraid to ask and look, of finding like immediate friends that are just like willing to like give you things and show you things, and like all these great communities that are actually looking about how they can help the community. And we felt like this was home right away. Immediately plugged in, and we did get to share that back too. So.
My name is Adriana. I'm Justin's wife, and just to add to his story there, he says, we've lived a lot of different places in the world, and this feels like home because of the community. I mean, we haven't found anywhere in the place we lived before that we need to become friends and like-minded people, and so many people are into permaculture here. This is insane. We haven't seen that before. And we have 3 acres and planning on growing a lot of food, and thanks to Wade and his classes and his consultations, we're just starting,
Just excited about hearing what you guys said, and just all the people that are interested in permaculture here. I think this is what's working.
Thanks, everybody. As we can see, that there is a lot of things that are happening in this community that are quite successful, and there's way more that we don't have spokesmen for that would testify to other programs that are in place that are working. So from personal self-reliance on your farm and growing a lot of your food to microeconomies and micro-movements, and just little nudges into the next sphere to better collaborate with each other, to a larger communal and regional system. There's a lot that's happening. We have the markets and the grocery stores dialed. There could be better. There could be different systems there for sure. And we have a lot of people growing food. Sometimes there's food growing on their land that they're not even aware of. It's just rotting on the ground. And so connecting those systems together is something that's come up quite a bit when talked about marketing and distribution and things like that. One of the first things that happened during the HSCA talks was the awareness that there is all this food and how do we get it to people, right? Like there's, after Azelle, people had so much breadfruit because it fell out of the trees because of the wind at the same time, but it does that every year, just slowly, and you don't notice. So there's abundance and how to get it to people. So apparently there was an organization called No Fruit Left Behind.
Yes.
And they're a gleaning organization that was on the other side of the island. I don't think we have, although someone did some work around that, that hasn't been really strengthened. So imagine if a system like that was in place where, there's people with a food hub truck that went around to different farmers and helped harvest their food, right? Gave them money for it, gave them percentage or commission for it, and helps get some of that food to people that need it, to pantries and food baskets and things like that, right? Like, so it's these bridging these gaps. It's that happens when we take sort of an eagle's eye view and look at it as a larger system, we begin to see what's in place, what's working, what parts are missing to make this a productive system, and then what can we build on to make it really vibrant and thriving, right? So we talked a little bit about what's working. The next part we're going to get into is about some of the holes that are missing. And you know, that our noticing mind can be really super active sometimes. Like, we're good at noticing, and that can sometimes turn like complaining or anger that it hasn't happened or whatever. And so I just want to reiterate the change process as I know is, you know, is notice, choose, act. So go from the noticing into choosing a choice, a solution, and then taking action. This is a really healthy way to move the noticing into proactive solutions for our food security future.
We'd love to grow on many stuff, maybe even backyard gardening, maybe doing a lot of the stuff that we just talked and strategized on, bringing classes, bringing community potlucks into the communities and learning more about what is it that your community is doing or what are you doing in your backyard and how can we learn and benefit from it. So
my vision going forward is also, like, I want to have a team of young folk that are like the permaculture action team, where we find people that have properties that want to grow food but don't really know what they're doing, and we can go there and like blitz their land and put in perennial greens and, you know, get their systems going and teach them how to do it and do it and then teach them how to keep it going. Mm-hmm.
One organization there, I know it's not in Hawaii, is called Grow Food Carolina, and they found after surveying all of these farmers that the biggest problem they had was marketing and distribution. So they created this hub where they would do the pickups and deliveries from all of the farms, and then the hub became the distribution center to get local produce to restaurants, to grocery stores. They would do all of the legal negotiations between the corporate headquarters, and so it wasn't the farmers doing that who didn't have the education to make those kind of negotiations necessarily. And then the farmers, and what they found was that so much less produce was wasted, because these farmers were just throwing away produce because they couldn't sell it in time. I think the community currency is a platform, you know, it's gonna grow into be a platform where people can trade produce locally just through individuals, and we are gonna start enlisting businesses. So, you know, that's an outlet to do it, but just something to share about how we can make the food sovereignty in Hawaii. We don't need to have this international trade to supply ourselves with what we need. So marketing and distribution is a huge part of it.
Right.
I was asked to be on the steering committee for the community currency, which I think is working. I think it's a work in progress, but it's already working, but it can improve, and part of that improvement is, you know, taking what's being discussed here and offsetting your cash expenses with each other, or with cash outlay for things you can train for, you know, from your own aina, your skills, you know, your gifts, your talents, whatever concoctions you can come up with, whether it's with noni or whatever it is, banana bread, or bananas, it doesn't matter. The first thing I wrote down was a network of trade and barter, because we get out of the money system and get into community, build our own economy within the economy. I think life becomes a little easier.
We now have Sunday markets that were held behind the Quins. The vendors are all now here on Sundays in Nanavali. And the gates open early, but the public can come in from 7 to 2 o'clock. And so, come on down, and if you'd like to be a part of that, I could use some volunteers come that day with setting up and taking down. And then I'd like to eventually have something like what Wade was sharing. I'd like to do a night market with our local people, with our local restaurants and our local farmers, and just kind of focus on them. So night market. So yeah.
And the O.U.R Konohiki concept is, I hope to like offer it in a way that it's like a concept that you take into your own life. It's decentralized. It's not, hopefully one day it'll be a series of community hubs throughout the community. But right now it is supporting these existing organizations. It is putting your energy and your money or your volunteer energy or your attention towards these existing organizations so they can strengthen and they can become stronger systems in voting with your dollar and making your old homestead self-reliant. So this is a concept that that we hope that exists inside of everybody and grows in the community. But what the dream is to create maybe first online and then physical structure is a place where there is more of these things happening. There's actually nothing on this list that doesn't exist somewhere in the world. Many of these things already exist here in Hawaii. So the O.U.R Konohiki concept really is just